our bodies are vulnerable to attack.
Nobody left to fight the cold and flu entry.
Because of our food.
Anything that ends in an os, that's a sugar.
We'll show you how to protect your health by watching what you eat on today's 700 Club.
It's a numbers game and a speed game.
Well, we've got a shocker for you today about Homeland Security. You will not believe what people are saying about that troubled agency. But first of all, if the Ebola outbreak spreads to major cities in Africa, it could lead to a, quote, unimaginable catastrophe. Well, that's the grim warning from the man who discovered the killer virus in 1976.
Some politicians say the United States should ban travel from countries infected by Ebola. And now, a nurse in Spain has come down with the deadly disease. Caitlin Burke has the story.
This morning, doctors in Spain confirmed the first known case of Ebola spreading outside the outbreak zone. A nurse who helped treat infected missionaries who were flown home has tested positive for the disease. Spanish health officials say she's being treated in isolation, and they're working to keep it from spreading further.
We're getting a list of all of those who could possibly have been in contact with her. We'll be in touch with all of these people to see up to which point there could have been contagion.
Lawmakers are urging the White House to restrict travel from the West African countries affected by Ebola. But the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention argue that would only hurt efforts to stop the outbreak and put Americans at greater risk. Meanwhile, health officials here in the U.S. remain on high alert while two Ebola patients continue to receive treatment. In Dallas, Thomas Duncan remains in critical condition. In Nebraska, American journalist Ashoka Mukpo so far is showing only mild symptoms.
He sounds very strong, and I think he shares in the relief of the rest of his family that he's been able to come back for good medical treatment here.
President Obama says that ending the Ebola crisis is a top national security priority. And he says the U.S. is working on new protocols to do additional screenings of airline passengers arriving from West Africa. Caitlin Burke, CBN News.
Well, Liberia has been ground zero for this deadly outbreak of Ebola, and CBN News is now on the scene there. Wendy Griffith has that story from the CBN newsroom. Here's Wendy.
Thanks, Pat. More than 2,000 people have died from Ebola in Liberia. But as George Thomas reports, Operation Blessing is there with important medical supplies to help fight this horrifying disease.
The panic and anxiety are palpable. Across this poverty-stricken West African nation, Liberians are struggling to contain their fear. The few Ebola treatment centers that are open are overwhelmed and understaffed with the sick and dying. Dozens of victims are dying daily. CBN News arrived in the capital city, Monrovia, late Monday night. The moment we stepped off the plane, each passenger had to wash their hands with bleach. A few feet away, nurses stood armed with thermometers to check temperature.
Lines of defense here against the undoing well, thank you, ma'am, against Ebola is right here at the international airport in Monrovia. Each person is checked coming in and also out of the country. Thank you.
Liberia has accounted for more than half of the world's deaths from the virus. Despite promises from the government here that the situation is under control, people on the streets aren't buying it. Folks are afraid of one another. There's no touching, no hugging, no pats on the back. Basically, people are keeping at least a full arm's length apart from each other. Operation Blessing has been on the ground helping. This week, the group will set up an additional 6 chlorine generators capable of producing hundreds of gallons of chlorine a day, allowing thousands to wash their hands thoroughly in chlorine water and then with soap to stop the virus. 10 more units are being dispatched. Some 100 chlorinated hand washing stations will also be delivered to affected villages far from the capital city. A 40-foot shipping container full of critical supplies like gloves, masks, and bed linens will make their way to Ebola treatment centers. Meanwhile, the daily urgency to get the word out about prevention continues. Teams of volunteers are holding awareness seminars across the country to make sure folks follow critical hygiene steps to keep from getting the virus. I'll continue to bring you the very latest on Operation Blessings Outreach, plus daily behind-the-scenes reports on life in the Ebola zone. Please join me for that and much more on CBNNews.com, Facebook, and Twitter. I'm George Thomas, CBN News, reporting from Monrovia, Liberia.
Thanks, George. We are praying for you and all the people there in Liberia. Pat?
Well, Wendy, I'd be very happy if George wasn't there to tell you the truth, because he's a very valuable member of our staff. But we want to show the people what's going on. And, you know, I've been involved in Liberia for some years, and we've seen some great things happening there. But what's happening right now is just a terrible tragedy. Wendy?
Yes, it is. Well, in other news, the Supreme Court opened the door Monday for same-sex marriage in several more states and possibly the eventual legalization of it across America. Voters in five states had approved measures banning gay marriage, but courts threw them out, and the Supreme Court let those rulings stand, making same-sex marriage legal in those states. It could be legal in up to 30 states soon, but supporters of traditional marriage say they'll keep fighting. Pat, what do you think?
Well, I think once again the courts have muddled the waters. You don't know, the Supreme Court has punted instead of taking a clear stand. There are a number of circuit courts that picked up on some verbiage that took place in another Supreme Court decision, and they're ruling, overriding the wishes of the states. State after state after state, the voters overwhelmingly voted to protect traditional marriage. Here in the state of Virginia, for example, there was an election. The man running as a Democrat for Attorney General said, I will support the laws that are on the books. That included the Defense of Marriage Act that was on the books here in Virginia by a referendum. The minute he was in office, he turned against it and did everything he could to undermine it. Now he's saying what a great day it is for Virginia that the homosexuals are getting married. The people didn't like that. But, you know, it's the same thing with abortion. Instead of letting the people decide, as they should have under the Constitution, it was taken out of their hands by a Supreme Court decision, Roe versus Wade. And because of that, no effort by the people has been successful ever since. And it's been a tragedy, as we've seen over 50 million unborn babies slaughtered in this land. Wendy?
Pat, it was created to make America more secure, but critics say the Department of Homeland Security is just another bloated bureaucratic mess. Paul Strand brings us this look at why some people say the massive organization could actually make America less safe.
9/11 was such a major catastrophe, it certainly seemed a call for making massive sweeping changes among the bureaucracies that failed to stop al-Qaeda that dark day. So the government went to work to put together a solution to prevent such a major terrorist attack from happening again.
But some critics feel that when President Bush and Congress created the Department of Homeland Security, they simply came up with an overarching, monstrously unwieldy super bureaucracy that may have been exactly the wrong solution.
CIA-trained retired Lieutenant Colonel Tony Schaefer works in the nuts and bolts of intelligence and analysis. He says the new department wasn't necessary.
All those organizations were essentially functioning very well where they were sat. So this is one of those situations where the government fixed something that was not broken.
Fearing that many of the departments and agencies that had to do with guarding the nation weren't working closely together enough, the Bush administration decided to force a total of 22 agencies into one giant new department called Homeland Security. Steve Bucci, now with the Heritage Foundation, worked for years as a Pentagon representative to Homeland Security.
Frankly, it was slapped together quickly, a ton of different organizations.
And Bucci says often a high-up official at Homeland Security doesn't really have the power he or she needs to issue orders to these agencies who were all shoved together.
He has to sort of cajole them into doing things rather than direct them.
Schaefer says there were serious personnel problems from the start.
Many of the organizations which donated people to DHS wanted to basically use it as a dumping ground to get rid of people who they thought were not the best performers. So when you take that as the baseline, it all goes downhill from there.
And both Schaefer and Bucci worry DHS is way too big and made up of parts that will just never fit together well. Imagine one department trying to oversee so many different agencies with nearly 250,000 employees. U.S. Customs and Border Protection alone has more than 60,000, the U.S. Coast Guard nearly that many. The Immigration Services and FEMA add another 60,000 or so. The Secret Service's 6,000 get shoehorned in there. And then finally, there's the agency so many Americans love to hate, the TSA, with more than 55,000 workers.
Just the size of it and the way it was put together from so many different parts have left a lot of overlap in some areas and gaps in others. They're still sorting that out, which at this point, so many years later, you would think they would have that worked out, but they don't.
Schaefer says it has so many functions, it's difficult to figure out its actual mission.
Yogi Berra once said, if you don't know where you're going, it's going to be hard to get there. And so this is very much the case for DHS.
And the major problem it was formed to solve still goes on. Agencies not sharing intelligence.
Some of it is the old information is power. And if we have it and we're working this issue, we don't necessarily want to share it with those other guys because then they might get the credit.
Schaefer says insiders tell him this.
Sharing of information and data today is worse than before 9/11.
Making it all even harder, a crushing amount of congressional oversight.
Those 22 agencies which were put into one now still have to report to over 100 different congressional committees for their oversight. It's really hard to get good when you have that many people looking over your shoulder and telling you what to do.
And inside, Bucci says there's a toxic culture from employees knowing that Homeland Security is rated the worst place in the government to work.
They're told DHS is the biggest, most bureaucratic organization ever. They're told DHS is inefficient. It's really hard to keep your morale up when you hear that. And when you are trying to do a good job, but you keep bouncing off this wall of bureaucracy.
So should Homeland Security simply be dismantled? Bucci votes no.
It may not be perfect. Backing up now and starting over again, I think, would probably leave us less safe than what we have now.
Schaefer disagrees. He says the department should be done away with because it's not only dysfunctional, it's actually harmful to its primary mission, the security of America.
You see an organization which actually, I think, is counterproductive to the point it gets in the way of other organizations trying to get their job done.
Paul Strand, CBN News, Washington.
Thanks, Paul. Pat, if Homeland's not sharing information, how can that make us safer?
Well, it doesn't, Wendy. This, you know, you like to criticize, I'm sure people like to criticize the Democrats, isn't Obama terrible, but this is a George Bush thing. I don't know if he picked this up at Harvard Business School or where he got it, but it's an absolute nightmare. It should never have been done. It was a bureaucratic blunder from the start. And my vote is to break it up. You can't have oversight by 100 congressional committees. You cannot have a couple hundred thousand employees doing disparate functions with no central purpose. And I experienced FEMA firsthand down in New Orleans. It was an absolute disaster, absolute disaster. Instead of helping, they stood in the way. For example, people in New Orleans during the height of Katrina were starving, desperate for water, desperate for help. We had trucks, Operation Blessing had trucks on the causeway just outside the city waiting to get in with all the supplies or with the supplies those people were looking for. Could they get in? No. Why not? Because FEMA kept them out because FEMA didn't quite have the right mix of bringing stuff in. And you find people in New Orleans trying to do something, and every time FEMA would stand in their way, and then suddenly they're spending an unconscionable amount of money. And you look at fields and fields and fields of these house trailers that nobody were using. It was a nightmare. And that is typical. Now we've got to mess with what used to be in the Treasury Department, the Secret Service, which is a highly specialized and highly skilled organization that has gone all to pieces. The director just resigned because of breaches of security at the White House that were just nothing short of shocking. My vote, break that monstrosity up and do it quickly and get it back to where it should be so that each organization has a discrete function and it knows what to do.
And can be accountable.
Accountable.
I mean, how can you be accountable in something that ginormous?
You look at that TSA, as I said, one Jamaican who was driving a car at an airport, he said it stands for thousands standing around. TSA, thousands standing. And but to think that it became a dumping ground for the less capable employees of various agencies, it's a shocking thing. But it's time Congress get hold of that monstrosity and break it up. Then we'll have some efficiency. But it's not making us safer. It's making us less safe. All right. Next.
Well, speaking of safe, we can have some personal hand in all of that, because we're going to talk to you about the food that packs the biggest punch to boost your immune system.
Tastes great. It's a breakfast dish. It's a lunch dish. It's a dinner dish in Korea. Whatever it is, it gives you great bacteria.
Find out what this food is, and we've got some other amazing tips for healthy living when we come back.
Our staff is determined to keep you healthy. They're going to do everything they can this week. This is the Immune System Week, and we're going to tell you tips to keep your immune system tuned up. Now it's the start of flu and cold season, and if you're one of those people who's habitually sick, your weak immune system could be the culprit. The good news, there's still time to strengthen your immune system. Today on our Protect Your Health series, Gordon talks about the power of food to make or break your health.
Americans love sugar. On average, we consume an astounding 32 teaspoons a day, more than four times the maximum recommended by the American Heart Association. We all know that too much sugar can lead to weight gain and diabetes. Here's something you may not know. Sugar severely weakens the immune system. Scientists found that within 5 hours of consuming 21 teaspoons of sugar, our white blood cells lose 40% of their ability to kill bacteria.
We think sugar, rather than impeding your immune function directly, helps the bacteria, helps the virus, helps, in fact, the cancer cells grow faster. So it does all the things to make the viruses and bacteria prosper, which means it's harder for you to kill them all. It's a numbers game and a speed game.
Sugar is hidden everywhere, in bread, pasta sauce, and even yogurt. And it's disguised with over 40 different names, like high fructose corn syrup.
Maltose, dextrose, fructose, etc. Anything that ends in an os, that's a sugar. Anything that has the word syrup in it, that's largely a sugar. Honey is a sugar. Maltodextrin. You got these weird things, organic, pressed, evaporated cane juice. So evaporated cane juice, evaporated juices, beet sugar, corn sweetener, anything that says sweetener on it.
Before you buy a product, scan the list of ingredients for sugar or any of its aliases. Brace yourself. Things that seem healthy, like fruit juice and sports drinks, are loaded with sugar. In addition to sugar, processed foods with trans fats and omega-6 fats also suppress the immune system by causing inflammation. Inflammation means your body is busy repairing itself instead of fighting disease.
Inflammation makes you vulnerable to attack someplace else. So let's say you've got inflammation in your knee. Well, all your white cells are running down there to fight the inflammation. There's nobody left to fight the cold and flu entry.
You should know those immune-busting trans fats also have an alias, hydrogenated oils, which you can spot on the list of ingredients. Cookies, crackers, and other packaged baked goods are loaded with them. These bad oils are also common in snacks, fast food, and frozen dinners.
You get more spread of the virus and bacteria if you have a lot of trans fat. Those are in processed foods. And so the same thing goes with omega-6s.
Sometimes it's not just packaged food that causes problems. The packaging itself often contains chemicals, like PFCs and BPAs, that have been shown to suppress your body's immune function. Many cans and food packages lined with plastic have these chemicals. especially microwave popcorn. And if you microwave your food, switch from plastic containers to glass, paper, or ceramic.
One of the easiest ways to decide you're eating healthy is avoid food in a package that isn't in its original form. So packaged food is really bad for your health, bad for inflammation.
Another obstacle to a healthy immune system is dehydration. The fact is, we don't drink enough water. Fluids flush out damaging toxins, while at the same time carry nutrients to infection sites. To check whether you're drinking enough water, look at your urine. It should be pale yellow. If it's dark yellow, you need to drink more. Speaking of drinking, while water is good, booze is bad for the immune system. Research shows drinking too much alcohol reduces the ability of white blood cells to kill germs. The more alcohol we consume, the more infections we get. Now that you know what to avoid, here are some things you can do to help boost your immune system.
The most important thing that feeds our defense system is in fact food and food choices. So what food you have, what foods you have, is key to whether you have a prolonged illness or short illness and whether you get sick at all.
A study in older adults showed that eating more fruits and vegetables improved their ability to fight illness. Foods especially high in immune-boosting phytochemicals are red bell peppers, berries, kale, onions, beets, garlic, broccoli, and shiitake mushrooms. Watercress is the new superfood. It's loaded with even more vitamins and minerals than spinach. Also make sure to eat fermented foods, such as pickles, sauerkraut, and plain yogurt. They grow the good bacteria that kill bad bacteria in our bodies. As a bonus, fermented foods can even help us lose weight.
In mice, there's studies where twins, the ones with the good bacteria stay thin, the ones with the bad bacteria get fat.
Dr. Roizen says, hands down, the fermented food that packs the greatest punch is kimchi.
It's a Korean, if you will, vegetable fermentation. So they take varieties of vegetables, cabbage and broccoli, every vegetable they can have, onions, and then they ferment it with this mixture. Tastes great. It's a breakfast dish, it's a lunch dish, it's a dinner dish in Korea. Whatever it is, it gives you great bacteria.
So fight colds and flu with a healthy diet. One free of sugar and processed foods, but rich in whole foods and plenty of water. You'll definitely feel better from the inside out.
Thanks, Gordon. I'm sorry I'm not eating kimchi. I don't care how much you tell me to do it.
Yeah, I've tasted that too.
Well, sauerkraut isn't too bad, though. I guess that's good.
And pickles. I mean, I did not know that.
Pickles, a little salt. I don't understand how they get that either, but yeah. Dr. Roizen is a good guy, isn't he? Mm-hmm. I mean, this is, if you could remember all this, we'll be sending you this to you if you want it this week.
Yeah, that's very exciting. We're showing each day a portion of this, but we're going to show you ways you can protect your health all week, build a strong immune system, and then we're going to give it all to you in one DVD. All you have to do is call the number that's on your screen. We'll send it to you. It's free. It will have all five segments on it. And, you know, as we come into flu season, even as we're hearing about Ebola, you know, this is the time of year where our bodies are just susceptible to so much. You want to have this information. All you have to do to get it is call 1-800-759-0700. We'll send you this Protect Your Health DVD absolutely free. If you give to CBN via Pledge Express, and many of you do, this DVD will automatically be sent to you. And we want you to know you can watch this series by going to our website at cbn.com. You know, lots of times I'm watching the program or I see it on the air and then I want someone else in my family to see it. It's so great that you can go online and watch.
Just like you got an impacted wisdom tooth, an infected molar or something, and so you get colds, and mm-hmm. Dr. Roizen said all your white cells are up there in your jaw.
That's right.
Curing that, and they won't be there to fight the influenza. Hey, that's something. I'm a fan of my wife, God bless her, went to the Price Club and brought back a great big bag of frozen blueberries, and they are loaded with antioxidants.
I know you eat a lot of berries and nuts.
Nuts. I mean, like, you know, cashews and all kinds of stuff. I mean, mm-hmm. I have, you know, you
it's
name
good for
it.
You.
But mixed nuts and seven grain cereal and, you know, oatmeal, things like that.
You don't have to have kimchi. There are other options.
You better believe I don't have to, nor
God.
Will I do it. That was the thing in Korea is kimchi and rice. And I didn't know what was in kimchi, but now yeah. I know and I don't want it.
Okay. Sometimes it's best not to
but
ask.
But you can buy it in a grocery store. But think of the way they're slipping sugar to us. Isn't that disgusting?
Yeah. Well, we need to be in the know about these things.
Yeah.
And as you said, to know the good alternatives.
High fructose corn syrup is a killer, but think of all the other ways they mask the sweetener mm-hmm. they're putting in there.
It's in many,
everything.
Many
yeah,
things.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, we're going to keep you healthy if you just let us. Please.
There you go. That's your way to get the free DVD. It's a
all
gift
right.
to you. 1-800-759-0700 to ask for it, or you can go to cbn.com. Well, coming up, he was living large as one of the biggest cocaine dealers in New York City until the day the feds came calling.
I try to, you know, jump out the window, and the cop is pointing his gun at me. He says, you know, freeze, freeze. And so I went back in and I told my wife, this is it. My life is over.
But it was far from over. Watch what happens when this drug kingpin finds himself facing 18 years to life.
Okay. Get plenty of rest and follow all the instructions on here.
Wow. Thank goodness for all those years of medical school, huh?
Oh, I'm not a doctor, but I do watch the 700 Club.
Protect your health and build a better, stronger immune system. The 700 Club brings you the latest steps to power up your well-being and boost your body's defenses. Experts from the Mayo Clinic.
They're your body's first defense of getting rid of the bugs, germs, bacteria, viruses.
The Cleveland Clinic.
If they can't function, then they can't destroy anything foreign that's in the body.
And many others show you how to live long and strong. Get your free DVD copy of Protect Your Health, 5 Steps to a Healthier Immune System. Call 1-800-759-0700 or log on to cbn.com.
Thanks.
Protect Your Health.
Hey.
Available now.
Are you putting yourself at risk? 90% of us are doing just that.
Their health benefits are really compromised.
We'll show you the simple ways you can protect your health.
And they need to start it early if they want it to be effective.
And fight off disease.
It is kind of that safety mechanism that could be added on board to support your immune system and overall health in general.
Our immune boosting series continues on tomorrow's 700 Club.
Herman Mendoza. Herman was riding high as a cocaine kingpin in New York City. Herman would spend as much as $20,000 a day partying with celebrities. But the party was suddenly over for Herman the day the feds came knocking.
Herman Mendoza was one of the biggest cocaine dealers in New York City. And in his mind, it made him invincible.
Because I felt that since I had all this money and I had this power, I felt that nothing can touch me.
One of 5 boys, Herman grew up in Queens. The streets were his playground and his influence.
I wanted for people to look at me and say, he's a tough guy, you know, we can look up to him.
At 14, he was a no-name corner drug dealer. In a few years, he started moving huge amounts of cocaine and had people working for him. By now, Herman was married. His wife, Alexandra, says it's not what she signed up for.
I'd rather be poor and be at peace and happy than having you go out there and make all this money and we're not at peace.
But Herman's reputation was growing and he wasn't going to stop now. In fact, he went into business with his brother, Eddie, and they soon rose to the top. Even that wasn't enough.
And so here we are in this lifestyle. You know, I was spending about $20,000 a day drinking, partying, going to different mansions of different celebrities. And so I was just living a crazy lifestyle, but it was always a void within me. You know, it was nothing that was satisfying me.
He and Alexandra now had two children. The lifestyle was lavish, but the stakes were higher. And Alexandra feared for their lives.
I remember always living in fear. Like, something's gonna happen to him, something's gonna happen to me, they're gonna come in here and kill. Like, it was always like a constant torture in my mind of what was gonna happen. What was our future gonna be like?
Their future unfolded in short order. Herman and Eddie were busted and facing 20 to life in prison. Herman made bail, Eddie didn't. 6 months later, Herman jumped bail.
The ordeal I was dealing with, now I'm facing life in prison, and I was just trying to, you know, in my mind racing, saying, what am I gonna do? And so every morning I would drink and I would pass out.
One morning, Herman woke up to the feds breaking down his door.
I try to, you know, jump out the window, and the cop is pointing his gun at me. He says, you know, freeze, freeze. And so I went back in and I told my wife, this is it. My life is over. I said, open that door and I'm gonna surrender.
Herman was looking at 18 years to life.
And I was at the breaking point. I was like, I've tried all other recourse. So my mind was racing and I was thinking, what am I doing here? Why did I sell drugs in the first place? And I started to cry.
As he awaited sentencing, Herman was transferred to a prison where he met a Christian. It was his brother, Eddie. It had been over a year since they saw each other.
And so he embraced me and he said, praise the Lord. I'm like, what are you talking about? Praise the Lord. I didn't understand his language, his new language, and he was so happy.
Herman saw a big difference in his brother.
He was in prison facing life too as well with me, but he was happy. He had a sense of peace, and I wanted that.
Herman went to chapel with Eddie. There, he says God spoke to him.
What you're missing is what I can give you, that peace that surpasses all understanding. I can fill that void. And so I went up to that altar and I just cried and cried and I gave my life to the Lord. I said, Lord, I receive you. I want you in my life. I want you in my heart. I need you. And so I started crying and crying and crying.
Meanwhile, Herman's wife had decided to leave him. But when she went to tell him, she saw something about him had changed.
Because it was, who are you? Like, I really didn't know who he was because it was like a shock to me.
And so I started sharing my heart with her and telling her that I was so sorry, that to please forgive me for all the transgressions, all the hurt, all the pain that I caused her and caused my children.
And he even told me, look, even if you never come back to me, even if you decide that this is it and you're gonna get a divorce from me, which you have all the rights to do, you know, I just want you to know, I just want you to be okay. I just want you to know the Lord.
Alexandra was so moved that she accepted Christ. She often visited Herman and their relationship grew stronger. Then after 4.5 years, Herman stood before a judge to be sentenced. He braced himself for the worst. Then the judge gave his decision. 5 years.
And I looked at my attorney and I said, did he say 5 years? He said, yes, he said 5 years. And I was just praising God.
Herman served his remaining time and is now a pastor in Queens, New York, sharing the message of God's love.
And so that day when I received Christ, he became the Lord of my life, that day I was born again, and this new life transformed me.
Peace, peace, my peace I give unto you. You know, there's no amount of money that'll give you peace. No amount of success will give you peace. No manner of political accomplishment or fame in television or Broadway or music or whatever you do. There's only one source of peace, and that source is Jesus Christ, who is the Prince of Peace. If you like peace, if you'd like to know peace in your life, I'm going to give you an opportunity right now. If you will just follow what I tell you, simple steps. I want you to pray. Pray with me the words I give you, and I want you to pray those words from your heart to the Lord, and He will hear and He will answer. So pray with me right now. If you want peace, you want salvation, you want joy, wherever you are, bow your head, these words from your heart, Lord Jesus Christ. That's right, Lord Jesus Christ. I'm a sinner, Lord. I haven't been living for you. I've lived for myself, and I've served other gods beside you. But I know, Lord, that you are the one true God. And from you comes peace and joy and love. So right now, I give you my life. I open my heart to you, and I ask you to come in. Come in, Lord. And from this moment on, I will live for you, and I will serve you. Thank you, Lord, that you've heard my prayer and have come into my heart. Now, I want to pray for you right now. If you prayed with me, I want to just bow your head, Father, in Jesus' name. For those who prayed, let the anointing power of the Holy Spirit touch them right now in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Amen and amen. I want to give you something. If you prayed with me, tell you what to do next. It'll tell you what you've done, what an exchange life means, what you're going to be a new creature in Christ. And I have a 73-minute CD, and I also have a little booklet here called A New Day. I'll give this to you free. Just call and say, I prayed with Pat. I gave my heart to the Lord. Toll-free number, 1-800-759-0700. It's easy to remember. Call now. You just prayed with me. Somebody's here standing by who loves you. Terry?
Well, still ahead, we've got your email. Lisa says, many people think that this person, the Long Island Medium show, can actually talk to your deceased loved ones. My own daughter thinks she's the real thing. Please tell me what the Bible would say about this so-called gift. Well, the answer to Lisa's question and more is coming up. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
Drank until about 5 o'clock in the morning, passed out, hit a car head on. I can't really express in words the hollowness of that feeling. I was sentenced to serve 7 years in prison. And my bunkmate, he just looked at me and shook his head, said, it's a real shame. You really have a heart that God could use if you would just let him.
God is a God of restoration, reconciliation, and redemption. There is always hope in Jesus.
And welcome back to the 700 Club. The second blood moon lunar eclipse of the year will take place Wednesday. People in North America will be able to see it early Wednesday morning if skies are clear. The moon will appear orange or red because of the sunlight in the atmosphere. That's why it's called a blood moon. And you can find Eric Stackelbeck's amazing story on the implications of blood moons for Israel on cbnnews.com. The Seattle City Council is replacing Columbus Day with Indigenous Peoples Day in the city. The resolution passed unanimously Monday. It celebrates the contributions and culture of Native Americans. Some Italian Americans objected, with one saying they had no problem honoring Indigenous peoples, but added, America wouldn't be America without Christopher Columbus. And you can always get the latest from CBN News by going to our website at cbnnews.com. Pat and Terry will be back with more of the 700 Club right after this.
To listen to our top songs of the week, go to CBN Radio at cbn.com.
Well, it's time to bring it on with the email questions that you've sent in. And Pat, this first one is from Lisa, who says, many people think that this person from the Long Island Medium show can actually talk to your deceased loved ones. She's coming to our city. My own daughter thinks she's the real thing. I want to show her in the Word where this isn't possible. It doesn't seem right to me that this person has the gift to connect to the spiritual world. Please tell me what the Bible would say about this so-called gift.
Well, it's pretty explicit. You know, in the Old Testament, they were to burn mediums in the fire. Where did they get the information? They got them from demon spirits. And that's where it comes from. Either that or they're faking, and a lot of it is just fake. It's easy to fake it. Here's a quote in the King James from Isaiah chapter 8. And when they shall say unto you, seek unto them that have familiar spirits, and unto wizards that peep and mutter, should not the people seek unto their God for the living and not the dead? And I think the idea that the dead are going to give material to you, but in the Old Testament, they killed them. It was that simple. Mm-hmm. Because they were in touch with demonic. They were called necromancers. They dealt with the dead. And this Long Island medium, boy, oh boy, your dear daddy says the following. So much of that is a fake. I don't know whether she is, but, you know, if she's not fake, she's in touch with demons. They're not talking to the dead people, all right?
Exactly. This is Madeline, Pat, who says, why does the Bible say Jews are God's chosen special people when most of the Jews I know aren't Christian and deny Christ's deity? Also, if Jews are God's special people above others, how do I become a Jew so I can be special too?
Well, first of all, we become Jews. We are grafted into Israel through the blood of Jesus Christ, who was the Jewish Messiah. And but we become part of Israel. But why are they chosen? They were chosen to receive the oracles of God. The Old and New Testament has come to us through the Jews. And the revelation of the God of the Bible comes through the Jewish people. That's why they're chosen. That's what they were chosen for. But unfortunately, because of that, for them, they have been persecuted like crazy. They've been persecuted and driven by the devil. The devil's tried to hurt them. And I know there are many Jews that say, if it's just the same with you, I'd rather not be chosen for this honor, because they have suffered so much. But that's what it is. It's the revelation of God, and the oracles of God were entrusted to them. All right.
Okay, this is Raymond Pat, who says, why is the Federal Reserve not owned by the people of the United States?
Well, there were some people who came over from Germany, the Warburgs and others, who really wanted to have a national bank. And the control of our currency is a big deal. And the big people, the big finance people, got together and went down to Jekyll Island in Florida, or off the coast of Georgia, actually. And there was a man from the Rockefeller interests. There were others. J.P. Morgan's people were represented. And Nelson Aldrich Rockefeller was another. And these people got together, and they said, what we're going to do is to set up a bank, and it will be owned by shareholders, actually. It isn't owned by the government, and the Federal Reserve is not. It's federal, but that's just the name. It is a bank that is owned by other banks, and the other banks are stock company banks. And it was a great scam that has been perpetrated on the American people. And if you go back and start looking at our currency, since the Federal Reserve was formed, the dollar, the value of the dollar, has gone from essentially 100 cents down to about 4 or 5 cents. Wow. Over that period of time. And we've had successive inflations and problems. But the whole idea was to control the commerce of our nation in the hands of a few. And it is amazing that it is a secret organization. The books, I don't think, have ever been audited. And it controls the money supply. But look in your pocket. You don't have a pocket. Let me get you a pocket.
I'd rather have your money.
I have a pocket. Well, I'll give you $1. Would you please read what's on the top of that?
Well, you asked me to do this without my glasses.
Well, without your...
Federal Reserve note.
That's right. Does it say anything about gold?
Not a thing.
So if you don't like this piece of paper, what do you do for it? You can exchange it for another. And what's the other going to say?
The same thing this one says.
It used to be, they used to say redeemable in gold. It's now a Federal Reserve note. They print our currency, ladies and gentlemen. And they fund the Treasury. The Federal Reserve buys bonds from the Treasury, and they give them this stuff. This is all paper. It's just Federal Reserve. It depends. That's what it says. Federal Reserve note. Okay.
Unbelievable.
It's one of the most incredible takeovers that has ever been known. And
and the few really even know the origins.
And, you know, but it happened during Woodrow Wilson's administration. And those guys went to Jekyll Island, and they, there was a financial panic, and they thought this is the way that we're going to keep people quiet. Mm-hmm. And well, there are many, many people. If you call for the breakup of the Fed, then everybody thinks you're some kind of a screwball. But nevertheless, we've had massive inflation, continuous, and now they're in hock. They have borrowed an incredible amount of money. I don't know if it's up to $3 trillion or so. Huge. But the Federal Reserve Board, to my knowledge, it's never been audited. And there are many in Congress that try to do it. You know, Congressman Ron Paul made a big deal of it. But nobody paid attention to it because they're so powerful. And they have got control.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, that's all the time for today. Good question, Raymond, I just say. Well, up next, being a single parent is not easy, as you can imagine. But for the dad you're about to meet, it was doubly difficult. Take a look.
6-year-old Donia's mother died a year ago, leaving her disabled father to raise her.
I was very worried about Donia after her mother died. I cannot work, so our only source of income is from my son, who collects garbage for recycling. He makes less than $2 a day, so we couldn't afford to send Donia to school. She just stayed home and did nothing all day.
Donia and her dad are part of a small Christian minority in Egypt. So when he heard about a Christian youth center supported by CBN, he enrolled her immediately. Suddenly, Donia's hope was renewed.
I am really happy because the teachers are very nice to me. I learned my ABCs and worship God.
Donia is thriving at the center, and she's a favorite among the teachers.
Donia is very clever. She is our best student. I know she'll be very successful one day.
This center provides more than a good education. Children also get hot meals here every day, and caregivers treat all the kids like family.
Anytime she is late to class, they come to check and make sure we are all okay. I'm so grateful for the center. Thank God for you.
Speaking into the lives of children and into the lives of their families, it's an amazing opportunity. That's possible because 700 Club members are committed to taking the message of the love of God to people around the world. And it begins by helping them right where they're at with whatever their need is. If you'd like to join the 700 Club and be a part of that kind of a missionary outreach, we'd love to have you join us. Our number's toll free. It's 1-800-759-0700. Just call and say you want to join with the rest of us. It's 65 cents a day, $20 a month for a general membership. There are many different levels of membership that you can join at, but do something today because together you and I really can make a difference. And by the way, our way of saying thank you to you when you join using Pledge Express, that's electronic monthly giving. It means your bank does all the work so you don't have to have stamps or envelopes or even remember to send anything. Our way of saying thank you for using that is to send you Psalms of Encouragement. This is something that Pat has done just recently, and I think you're going to really love it. In fact, Pat, I think you'll be blessed by this. This is Elaine from Buell, Idaho. She says, "Powerfully anointed of God, I was under a dark cloud for years, could not seem to break free from oppression. I opened the mailbox on September 4th, put Psalms of Encouragement on in the car, and listened and was set free from a spirit of oppression."
Praise God.
I'm very grateful. Thank you, Pat Robertson, and all who gave to this CD.
The entrance of thy word.
Yes, I said DVD. It's a CD.
The entrance of thy word. It's liberating.
All right. Yes, and I mean, this it will bless you. These are encouraging psalms read for your enjoyment, but also for your edification, as Elaine was just sharing happened to her. So we want you to have that. Well, up next, we're going to be praying for you and for your needs. So stay with us. Back in a moment.
This year, wouldn't you like to make it through the cold and flu season without getting sick? America's top health experts reveal the best ways to get your immune system in tip-top shape. How much sleep is enough? Can your diet make you a target for disease? How do you decrease stress? Which supplements are best? And which exercise gives the most benefit? Get your free DVD copy of the 700 Club's Protect Your Health, 5 Steps to a Healthy Immune System.
CBN presents Psalms of Encouragement.
Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake.
Our gift to you when you join Pledge Express.
Time to pray for you before the end of the show. Here's something. Rebecca, who lived in Cross Lanes, West Virginia, had a skin condition for years. The doctors couldn't understand exactly what it is, but her hands were blood red. They became irritated and painful. As soon as she lay down, her hands would start burning. And then one day, she was watching this program. Terry had a word of knowledge. Somebody else, you have a burning skin condition. It's not from a burn. It's something that causes your skin to feel like it's burning. And I'm just pleased to report that God healed Rebecca because of that word of knowledge.
Praise the Lord. Well, here's another. For 2 years, Christopher, who's from Dallas, had a deteriorating esophagus from severe acid reflux. A biopsy showed 89% of the lining of his throat had been burned. He couldn't even walk for long without running out of breath. So bad, he actually considered having a tracheostomy done. One day, he was watching this program. Pat, this is what you said. You've burned the inside of your throat. It's almost like a kind of acid. The skin is so raw and painful. Right now, put your hand over your throat in the name of Jesus. Touch. That skin is going to be whole. He felt warm and tingly. The pain stopped, went back to his doctor. No more burning in the lining of his esophagus.
Praise God. Listen, God is powerful, and he has entrusted all of us together. If we pray and speak his word, he will do miracles. Now, Terry and I are going to join together. We've got a short time, but we want to pray for you. Now, please pray with us right now. In the name of Jesus, we pray for people, oh God, in this audience. There are people who are suffering in Jesus' name. And we pray that you would reach out to them and touch them and heal their bodies in Jesus' name. Touch! Terry.
There's someone, you have some kind of a problem in the lining under the lid of your eyes. It's itchy. You have like little blisters there. God is healing that condition for you. You'll not have it again.
You've got severe psoriasis, and you've cried out. You've done everything in the world, seen doctors, and you just said, oh, God, is there no answer? And the answer is right now. God has just touched you. Receive a healing in Jesus' name.
And someone else with burning
you,
on
Lord.
The soles of
thank
your
you,
feet.
Lord.
God's healing
thank
that
you,
for you now in Jesus' name.
Thank you. Well, thank you so much. You can call. We've got counselors on the phone. And we leave you with today's Power Minute from Psalm 30. Oh, Lord, my God, I cried out to you. And you healed me. Well, tomorrow, the supplements that will supercharge your immune system, plus award-winning singer Aaron Schust on tomorrow's 700 Club. So we'll see you then for Wendy and Terry and all of us. Goodbye. God bless you.